All right, at 7 o'clock, we'll call the meeting of the Conway Select Board to order on Monday, August 22nd. Frontier Community Access Television, FCAT, is taping this program for future viewing by the public. First item on the agenda is the minutes for the August 8th meeting. Has everybody had a chance to review the minutes?
Yes.
Okay, any changes or corrections?
Great.
Good to me.
No? All right, I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes of the August 8th meeting. Do I have a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next item on our agenda, we have three warrants. We have a vendor warrant for $135,832, a payroll warrant of $72,356, and a payroll deduction warrant of $18,393. I'll make a motion that we approve those warrants.
Second.
I have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Meetings attended by select board members since the August 8th meeting?
Been kind of
quiet the last couple of weeks.
We've had a lot of communication among the MCAT. I don't know if this is where the talk about it. It's not a meeting, but the, and there's a document in here, but we can talk about it at some time.
Okay. All right. Citizens' concerns. Do we have any citizens' concerns? Not seeing any. We'll move on. Okay. First item on our agenda, old business, is to meet Melissa Patterson, recent appointee to the Open Space Committee.
And she is supposed to be here. I do expect her. She's
okay. We'll just put her in later on the agenda. We also have Michelle Duguay coming in a little later as to offer her the position of the clerk for the Highway Department. She'll be in at 7:30. Next item on our agenda was to sign the revised contract for Davenport for the South River Floodplain Lowering Project. However, that contract has still not come in. So we'll table that to a future meeting. Next item.
Just one note on that. The project is moving ahead. Mm-hmm. They have started work on it. They did sign the original contract, and they are moving forward with that. One of the changes that they're looking for is something that may be covered in the contract anyway, which is the ability to do some paperwork after the end of the field work, which has to be concluded by the end of September. They've also introduced another question about retainage that they're working with the FERCOG on. I don't think the town's retainage is going to be affected by that.
Okay.
Hi, come in, please.
Hi, how are you?
This is Michelle Duguay.
Hi.
Michelle, I'm John O'Rourke.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah,
nice to meet you.
Bob Arthur.
Hi there.
Good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Okay. We'll go back up to that agenda item with Michelle. Michelle, why don't you tell us a little about yourself?
Currently, I work for the town of Sunderland. I'm the, they call police clerk right now. I also work for the highway department there, under George Emery, and I do his payroll and billing and help him handle all his business. So
you have a lot of experience at this.
I do. Before that, I worked in Deerfield with the police department, and prior to that, I was the assistant treasurer collector in Deerfield for a short stint. So I do have a lot of experience.
John, you want to tell us a little about the selection process?
Yeah, we got, was it... Eight applicants for the position, and Michelle stood out among them.
Thanks.
We did interview two finalists who were both very well qualified. Michelle has, as you've heard, a tremendous amount of municipal experience, mm-hmm. Which I think will be absolutely invaluable to the highway department here.
And the selection committee is recommending that we appoint Michelle.
Yes, more of a working group in this case. It was Ron and myself who did that process.
Okay. Well, I'll make a motion that based on Michelle's experience and the approval process that Tom and Ron went through, that we offer the position of clerk of the Highway Department to Michelle Duguay. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle.
Appreciate it.
Welcome aboard.
All right.
Do this again?
All right. Thanks. We'll talk to you.
He needs all the help he can get.
Yes.
You didn't have to laugh.
I'm giggly first.
Thank you.
See you.
All right, next item on our agenda was supposed to be a presentation by Lee Whitcomb, our administrative assessor, but she asked that be tabled for tonight, and it will be presented at the next meeting. Okay, the next item on our agenda is the drought watch management, recommendations and mandatory measures.
I think we have Melissa?
Yeah.
Oh. Please come in.
Great.
Melissa, okay.
Hi.
Hi.
Melissa John O'Rourke.
Nice to meet you.
Robert Baker.
Hi.
Bob Armstrong.
Hi, nice to meet you. We met before. Good
yeah.
to see
yeah.
you.
So Melissa, you're the Open Space Committee. You want to be appointed to that, huh?
Yes. Well,
okay.
You did actually do the appointment. Already,
we already did the appointment.
So, but we're introducing her to the town.
We're meeting
you're
with
on,
Melissa.
You're on TV as we speak here.
Excellent.
Tell us a little about yourself, Melissa.
Well, I'm actually a native to the area. Grew up in South Deerfield, and went to college in Pennsylvania. And then lived in different places around New England since. Got involved with AmeriCorps, and so I was a program director for an AmeriCorps program actually out in Holly, the Student Conservation Association and AmeriCorps program. So the members did environmental education and trail work across the state. We worked with BCR. So I was there for 7 years, and then just slid into a role with the Franklin Land Trust last year. We partnered, when I was at the SCA AmeriCorps program, we worked a lot with the Franklin Land Trust, and so when I was ready to move on, it kind of was a natural transition. So I moved to Conway a year ago. I live on 173 Whately Road, the old bed and breakfast at Pumpkin Hollow. Cool. And so
sure. Yeah, Diane Pollan's place.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
So
beautiful old house.
Beautiful place. Yes. Yeah, I love Conway. Great town. So.
And that's a great location right there, Pumpkin Hollow with the the common right out in front of you there.
It's awesome. Right. Yep, a great neighborhood. Everyone's really friendly. Good. Really, really love it.
Great.
Yeah.
Close to the pool too.
Close to the pool. Yep.
Walking distance at the pool.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yep. So, and I'm really interested in everything that the Open Space Committee's been working on and is working on in terms of, you know, certainly the project over at Rose Field, invasive plant management and creating open spaces has been a lot of my background. And certainly dovetails, you know, I'm not joining as part of wearing my Franklin Land Trust hat, but some of my experience there may help here and there. So.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, it's great that you're volunteering for that because it's it's a very important committee here in town.
Yeah.
Tom, do you have anything else?
I don't have anything else on this.
Okay.
No.
Melissa, welcome aboard.
Thank you. Thanks
Thank you very much for volunteering.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming in.
Nice to meet you too. Thanks
Thank
so much.
Thank you.
So don't forget to get sworn in and do your
yes, I got the letter. Okay.
Just stand in front of Jenny.
Okay, sounds
it's
good.
It's a very long process, the swearing in process.
Okay, I'll be ready. Okay. Thanks.
Have a good night.
You
too. Okay, the next item on the agenda, the voice of Conway.
Okay.
Dave Chichester is going to present the drought watch management recommendations and mandatory measures. David.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Pleasure to be here.
Oh, of course.
I see. You don't see much of you anymore.
No, I know. I'm hiding. The
Massachusetts Emergency Management Association, fondly known as MEMA, has taken a lead role in trying to get out in front of the drought situation. It's a little bit uncertain because it has to do with weather. But they had assembled a number of state agencies last week, including the fire agency, conservation committee, other members of MEMA, the Department of Public Health, and also the rest of the Emergency Management Association people, and they included weather experts from NOAA. And they're trying to get a handle on what's going on with respect to the drought. They know that there's been five consecutive months of dryness, getting to be very unusual in the weather pattern. They know that the reservoirs are drying. They're getting much lower. The streams are disappearing, and the groundwater would appear to be getting lower as well. So there's a great deal of concern amongst all of the agencies, not knowing what's going to happen. This is not by any means at this point an emergency, but these different groups and the group that are coming together as a collegial organization want to make sure that they're getting information from the towns, that they know how many wells are drying up, if indeed that's happening. And we know that in Asheville there have been a couple of wells drying up. Mm-hmm. Nothing in Conway as of this point in time. Of course, a lot of the concern has to do with the public water supplies, which are mainly in the eastern part of the state. Sure. Which affect a great deal more people en masse. So they are asking all of the towns to visit their permitting language to see what kinds of enforcement opportunities or authorities they might have in the town should the time come that they really have to get very restrictive about the use of water. There's also an effort to get remedial plans put together, such as tankers, to be able to make sure that they are available, that there's plenty of bottled water available for any particular towns or for larger areas that might be affected also. So there's that response portion of their message that's coming out. So there was a conference call last Friday afternoon, Tom. You did hear it.
Yes.
And there were like 400 and some people who participated in the conference call. Uh-huh. And various agencies gave statements and talked about some of the remedial work that could be done or the preparation work that could be done right now. And they're suggesting at the state level that they recommend that towns just step out front, let people know that we're concerned, that we're working with the state agencies, and that we're ready, willing, and able to take any steps that are necessary to protect ourselves and to become responsive to this possible emergency. Well, whether it happens or not, nobody knows. But the weather people are saying this could go on for several months into the fall, mm-hmm. for sure. And certainly, as Bob knows better than I, the fire hazard is much riskier now than it has probably ever been, certainly in my experience here. That's of great concern, is the hydrants and the ponds, your fire ponds. I don't know what the condition of those are right now, but they're probably lower.
Very lower.
Yeah. So the strategy here from my perspective is to just suggest that we let the townspeople know that we're on top of it. We're working in a very collegial way with the rest of the agencies in the state. We are concerned, and we would like to get information from anybody who has a well that's drying up, that has a situation that might be of importance to us, so that we can report that to the state. And the state is trying to collect data from the, it would be MEMA, the Emergency Management Association, that's trying to collect this data.
So who would they report that to?
Well, it would start with me in town. Or Carl Nelke. I've talked with Carl Nelke, the chair of the Board of Health, and he's very willing to wants to step into this as well. And he will be. He and I will be talking. And I assume that anyone else who has any issues or concerns, I'd be happy to talk with them about it. I don't have any more predictive ability than anybody else. But so we don't know how this is going to work. But hopefully we'll get into the fall and with proper conservation that in each of the towns, with people a little bit more conscious of conserving. We'll get through this. Okay.
Sorry. I have had general conversations with I know at least two people in town that have shallow wells.
Yes.
Not an artesian. And they looked in theirs recently and discovered that it was a lot lower than they thought. And they're in the conserving mode themselves just so they can don't dry their own well up.
Right. I think there are some people who think that because we have wells, and some of them are like mine is 450 feet, that there is nothing to worry about. Well, that isn't necessarily true. If the whole groundwater system is diminishing, it is something to be concerned with. So those of us with private wells should be just as concerned as those with public water supplies where you just turn on the faucet all the time and the water comes out.
Right.
So we have, Tom and I have talked about some kind of a statement that we might want to put out, and my recommendation is that you, the select board, do put out a statement which really says, okay, everybody, we're on top of this. Mm-hmm. We're not getting panicky about it, but we're on top of it, we're monitoring it, and we consider it to be a concern, and we urge people to take whatever conservation measures they can, and we've laid out some of those in the statement.
I'm going to read the statement from the select board right now, Dave.
All right.
So that we have some more additional information in addition to what our emergency management director has given us. The select board asks Conway residents to adopt water-saving techniques into their daily routines and follow best water conservation practices to help reduce the threat and enable groundwater and reservoirs to rebound more quickly if conditions improve. These may include limiting outdoor water use, avoiding watering plants and lawns, covering swimming pools when not in use to minimize evaporation, sweeping driveways, walks, patios, and other outdoor areas with a broom rather than hosing them off. Other conservation techniques include reducing shower times. Okay, reducing shower, that would be it. That's a tough one. Washing only full loads of laundry and dishes, turning off the tap when brushing teeth or shaving, and fixing water leaks in household items. So that's basically the nuts and bolts of our statement from the board. And certainly, as Dave told us, water conservation is starting to get to be a critical issue here in Western Massachusetts. And we thank you for being here, Dave, and thank you for all that you're doing with emergency management, too.
Do you have a recommendation for us as to how we might go about getting this out to the public?
I have written a little bit larger piece that Tom and I think maybe I could put in as a press release in the recorder. It's just about time to put it in the Visitor, the Visitor deadline, and Caring Conway, and I have kind of a list of all of those.
How about the telephone system?
Well, that's a good question.
We don't use it.
We don't use it. I mentioned to Tom that it hasn't been tested now. I'd like to test it at least twice a year. Mm-hmm. Hasn't been tested since before the town meeting, as I recall. I forget the exact date. And it is timely to try to do that. Another reason would be to weed out any people who have moved out of town or for other reasons have left. So that would be something that I could do. As you know, Bob, particularly, we have always considered that system to be an emergency announcement.
You've done very good with that.
Right. I didn't want to use it for frivolous stuff. Mm-hmm. But this is important enough
so it
perhaps should be put out there real soon.
Sure.
I think that's a good.
We're having a meeting of the emergency response team tomorrow night at the school, I thought maybe I would bring that up as an agenda item so that it isn't unilaterally decided to use that system, so we have kind of a good consensus that was the, would be the way to go.
Sure.
Yeah, Tom?
Yeah.
I was going to mention that and the press release idea as well. I think we should probably try to get quotes from at least John and Bob as fire chief as part of that press release before putting it out. And we can always make up the quotes and see if you agree to them. But you can give us some of your own if you like as well. And just, you did say, you know, the possibility of mandatory measures. It's my understanding now, after listening on that phone call, that there are mandatory measures in place for communities with, especially that are in the extreme drought area, with public water supplies. It's part of their permit conditions that they have to do things.
Right.
So that's not something that applies to Conway.
But we have reservoirs in town. Are they all in good shape? Are they okay?
No, if you've driven by the Whately one, it's very low. Yeah. Have you had any experience from the fire perspective? Any of your fire ponds drying up?
They're lower than they normally are.
But they're still there.
Knock on wood, we haven't had any emergency fire calls.
Right. Just getting it out of the South River, I would think.
I have dug in the ground with my little garden tractor down 2 or 3 feet, and it's like talcum powder.
Yeah.
Mm. It's scary dry.
Yeah.
So. Thank you, Dave. Appreciate you coming in.
Thank you.
Our next item on our agenda is to set dates for community development strategy meetings.
Yes, I've been working on the community development strategy. This is an updated version from the last one that the town had. It's more or less a template that then things get added to. And this is, you know, somewhat updated, and the idea is to send this out to a whole bunch of people in town for whom we have email addresses, and publicize a meeting that would be held in late September or early October. I'm suggesting, I think, October 5th would be a good time to have that. Then
it's a Wednesday, right?
Yeah, that would be my, I think that would be a good time to do it. I'd get it out at least a month beforehand. I wanted to get it out to you first so that you can look through it and suggest any of your own changes, just to make sure that what went out is reflects your priorities as much as possible. This document is based on our previous document. It was updated by FERCOG staff, and then I added some more updates to it as well, based on recent work here. But again, I did want to make sure all of you had the chance to look at it. So over the next week or two, and then I can get it out by the first week in September. Before the next select board meeting, and then in about a month after that, have a meeting. We get some further input, and then we bring it back to a select board meeting. And that meeting that we have in October 5th, that actually cannot be a regularly scheduled select board meeting. It has to be its own event,
right?
Focused on this, and then. We give it to the Regional Housing Authority, and they make it part of their application. And this would be primarily at this point for housing rehabilitation funds.
Okay.
We do have a revolving fund, but the need does exceed the amount that we have in it. That said, the more need we can show, the better. So if anyone out there in television land has a need for housing rehabilitation and meets the income guidelines that are posted on townofconway.com, please let me or the Regional Housing Authority know. All that information is available on the website. So,
okay, when do you need any comments or additions to this?
Again, over the next week would be good, definitely before the next select board meeting, and I'll get it out probably the end of the week before the next meeting. So end of next week.
Okay, so we're talking
middle of next week would be best.
Okay. All right, so we're talking about by the 31st, which is next Wednesday.
That would be very helpful.
Okay, fine. So anybody who has any comments or additions to this, let's get it to Tom by next Wednesday. All right.
You sent out a couple of possible meeting dates, I thought, related to this on the 7th and the 15th, or was that something else?
I think that's something else.
Okay.
Yes, that's the long-term financial planning part of the community compact.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Next item on our agenda is to review the community compact long-term financial planning meeting dates and plans. All right, Tom.
Well, you just stole that thunder, didn't you, Mr. Armstrong?
I just wanted to make sure
yes.
It wasn't this.
Yes, and that is those are the dates. September 7th and 15th are the dates that Joe Markarian is able to make it.
Because the 15th is now when we're going to have our next FCAT meeting.
Well, okay. Sounds as though...
So the 7th is a Wednesday. That's 2 weeks from this Wednesday?
Right.
Yes, and those are the two dates he can make it.
Okay.
What time, Tom?
I'm assuming 7 o'clock. I actually hadn't set the time yet.
I thought there were daytime meetings.
Huh? Oh, no, we weren't.
There were daytime meetings?
Well...
This is Joe coming in to talk to us about this.
Yes.
Just
to be better for
we do definitely want people from the finance committee there, especially Jim Bosman.
Okay.
And of course he works. And I understand. Well, those are the two dates that he has available. So I did include an outline of some of the things that he would go over.
Right.
And wanted to get that out to you guys early as well so that you can give any input you have on that as well. I think it covers the waterfront pretty much. It'll be difficult to get through the basics of this, I think, even in two nights. There will be significant work to do after that for the town to work through what it wants for the policies on all of these different topics.
Yeah.
So with any luck, we can get this information out to everybody who would be involved in that. And again, I sent out a list of that earlier. There's certainly at least one person, if not more, from the Finance Committee, Capital Improvement Planning Committee. Mm-hmm. I know the Treasurer is interested. I know the Administrative Assessor is interested.
Mm-hmm.
At least one person from the select board, I think, would be good. Mm-hmm. And, of course, I'll be there as well. So that's our normal sort of financial team that we have in place. But it'll be very important to have people on the same page as we go through all of these options for policies.
All right, let's set it up for the 7th and get an announcement out to everybody that you want to show up.
Yeah, and again, I think two meetings are going to be necessary. He is available the 7th and the 15th. The more time we can spend with him, the better, I think.
Yeah, sure.
And it won't be the end of it when those meetings are over, but we will, with any luck, have
better idea.
A good idea of what work we need to do in order to... get these policies approved.
Good. Next item on the agenda is to sign a letter of support for the Town of Deerfield Mass Works application. The Town of Deerfield has requested that we send a letter to the Mass Works Infrastructure Program concerning their water pollution control facility headworks upgrades in Deerfield. Again, this doesn't affect us. It just shows that we're willing to support their application.
The original template did did include language about the possibility of this benefiting our own wastewater situation. And it was a template for all of their neighboring towns, mm-hmm. and I thought that it really wasn't appropriate for Conway. So they had also mentioned economic development as a possible benefit to us as a neighboring town. I thought I would emphasize that aspect mm-hmm. in this letter and remove the other language.
Yeah. Has everybody had a chance to read this?
Yeah.
Any changes you want to make to this? No? We're okay with it? All right. We'll make a motion that we sign this letter of support to MassWorks infrastructure program for the town of Deerfield for their water pollution control facility headworks upgrades. I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
My next item on our agenda is to review the public safety costs for the Festival of the Hills. Okay, Tom, you want to go over that for us?
Yes, I have been working with the public safety staff here to come up with how much it costs to provide public safety services to the Festival of the Hills. The police department has been paying their members annually for this event and has included it as part of their regular budget. So that was that was a little bit easier. The volunteer services were, we had to think a little bit about what it would take to do it and how to minimize costs for the Festival of the Hills. So with the levels of staffing that are discussed in the text, we came up with the cost of service summarized in the chart, which is a little over $2,100 for the cost of providing public services for the Festival of the Hills. I wanted to show this to you and to see if there were any responses to anything here before I sent it to the festival.
Now, the Festival of the Hills, they've become a private organization at this point. In the past, we had provided all these facilities to them for basically it was part of the town's budget. So they didn't
yes,
pay anything
to it. It was volunteer effort.
It was volunteer.
Yes.
Okay.
The police were paid for, and
police budget, right?
Yes.
And budget for that every year.
I believe the fire and ambulance was volunteer.
So there was no out-of-pocket expense for the Festival of Hills, basically.
Right.
Okay. Well, other than the police department.
It was in their budget.
Well, it was in the budget.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the money they raise goes to scholarships for Conway students?
Yes.
Okay. How much do they generally raise for this event a year? Do we know?
I don't know how much they raise. I know they give out about $10,000 in scholarships.
Okay. All right.
Or they have given that out.
And that all goes to Conway students?
Yes.
Okay.
I was told, I don't know if this is accurate information or not, that they're supposedly holding on to $14,000 from last year still.
Yes, the cost
of operating this year's
operating expenses for this. Yeah. Okay. That's okay. I can understand. Is there any way we can get this lower? Because basically, what we're doing is we're taking money from the Festival of the Hills that would go for scholarships to, you know, basically pay for these services.
Well, not all of the money that they, I mean, they have costs to running the festival as well.
Sure. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, it's not all of this money is going for scholarships. We have lowered this cost. The original estimates were much closer to $2,600. So we brought it down by about 20% by being a little bit more creative about how we would use staff there, especially the police, which are, as you can see, by far the most expensive part of the operation here.
I, just speaking on the fire end, John, I can ask my people if they'd be willing to volunteer their time again. I have no idea what their answer will be. I will explain to them what the other proposal costs for the other two departments are. And it could be a possibility, it may not be. I don't know. I don't know how they would vote on that.
Okay. Isn't this already in the police budget for this year?
I believe it is.
Okay. So that $1,400 is already in the town budget?
I'm going to have to check on that. I will have to check on that.
Because, you know, essentially the Festival of the Hills is an extremely important event for the town. And, you know, I'd love to see us get this number down really lower than this so that, you know, they have the money to give out the scholarships. Bob, do you have any comments?
I mean, the costs are all reasonable. I think it would be great if people volunteer. It seems like we always paid this anyway, just a question of whether
we paid it out of the town.
Comes out of the town or, yeah. Or out of the festival.
Yeah.
Will this be a surprise to them?
Oh, they're well aware of the general figures, and I think the main question is the precedent that it sets for nonprofits having events in town and the town providing public safety services for them.
Well, I think this is different than what an ordinary nonprofit would be in town, since this is basically a town event. And essentially, you know, our Festival of the Hills committee, they do a fantastic job. They do a lot of work. I would really hope we could get this number down a bit, you know, because again, the money goes to scholarships to Conway kids. So basically, you know, we're taking money away from that. And I'd really love to see this number come down.
Well, of course, we're not in charge of the festival budget. And again, the festival has a lot of expenses that are not the scholarships as well.
Sure.
You know, it does take a good deal to get it ramped up each year, which is why they do have that amount in reserve. And it is a major event.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments on expenses for this? Well, the Festival of the Hills this year is October 2nd, right?
6th, I think.
Is it the 6th?
Oh, it might be the 2nd. I think maybe it was the 6th last year.
I think it's the 2nd. That's the first the first Sunday
first
in
Sunday
October.
Yeah.
Yeah, 2nd.
It's the 2nd. Okay.
I was thinking last year.
So they need an answer on this pretty quick. In terms of their total cost. Do they know this number right now?
No.
The
last number they had was, I think, closer to the higher number that we had before we reworked the police hour.
Okay. So this $1,400 is actually in the town budget for this year?
I will have to check with Ken about that.
Okay. So there's a possibility that this could come down to less than $750 if that's in the town budget at $1,400?
If we decide to spend the town budget on this event, yes.
Yeah. Okay. What would prohibit us from doing that? Would that be considered a donation to a nonprofit?
That is part of the concern. Again, and it's providing town services to entities that are not the town, and that does, in order, it is entirely a policy matter, and I understand what position you're taking. If there were other town groups, say the Conway Pool, for instance, wanted to have an event at their place and have public safety there for free, would we do it for them? If there were other community groups that had events, you know, we've had bike rides, we've had races, we've had all sorts of things. That's the policy question, which is yours to decide.
Yeah. What's the guidance that we receive from the Department of Revenue on this? Have we?
No, our accountant has advised against spending town money on private events.
Okay, and that probably comes from DOR. That advice.
Yes, this is probably a bit of a gray area. Mm. But I can try to find out more detail on that as well.
Okay. What's the feedback we've gotten from the Festival of the Hills Committee on the numbers we've given them so far?
Well, the representatives were didn't like the idea of paying for public safety services. They stating that it would cut into their what they made.
Yeah.
And therefore, what they were able to give out.
Right. Yeah. So this directly lowers what they can give out in scholarships.
Yeah. There was a point of view expressed that this could make it not worth giving out any scholarships. But I'm not sure if I understood that correctly.
Okay. I don't, that seems like a bit of a radical position.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is there any way we can get this a little lower than it is?
Well, again, if this is built into the budget and the chief believes that it's a good expense of town money, or you present that as a policy, obviously, if the fire and ambulance services donate their time and money, just to be clear, it would set a precedent for the town providing town services to private organizations. And if that's
this is a unique situation, I think.
Well, all situations are unique. Yes.
This one in particular. Okay. Let's table the decision on this until you check that, and at our next meeting we'll come up with a final decision. Is that good with everybody?
Would you like me to speak to the Amherst director also? On that or Tom? Or?
Oh, sure, if you'd be willing to.
Yeah, that'd be great.
That'd be very helpful.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is items not anticipated 48 hours in advance of the meeting. Tom, do we have any of those?
I do not.
Okay. Tom, your update?
So I do have one minor thing here.
Oh, you do?
So is that under concerns of the select board, maybe?
Well, I was going to...
Okay. Oh, or you have an item of business.
Okay, we can talk about it then.
Yeah, we haven't gotten to this yet.
Okay.
Just a few things, actually. Alan Singer has been appointed to the vacant finance committee slot. He runs the loan program at the Community Development Corporation in Greenfield, Franklin County Community Development Corporation.
Oh, great. Okay.
Does he live in town?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, he has to, ever since the town meeting voted May.
I haven't heard the name ever mentioned before, so I asked.
He works hard.
I've probably seen him, I just don't
I've seen him in Greenfield. We are looking for a new laborer for the highway department. The current laborer has submitted his resignation effective August 19th. Our new highway department clerk will be working with the highway supervisor on that posting. On the community compact IT project, I met with Linda Dunleavy of the Franklin Regional Council of Governments and Northeast IT, who won the bid for a cybersecurity template for small towns. We set a general timeline, and we'll meet again September 1st to go over a proposed outline. They're going to come up with a template and then apply it to Conway specifically, see if they need to rework the template, and then that will be made available by Mass IT to towns in the Commonwealth.
So we're basically the pilot.
We are out in front.
That's good. Okay. Great.
For projects, work has started on the South River Floodplain Lowering Project. The major work will start Friday and will continue through the end of September. I have posted on the website, notice on the website to let people know. Little bit more on the community development block grants. I'm working on that grant application process with the Council of Governments and the Housing Rehabilitation Authority, specifically for housing rehabilitation funds, as our current revolving fund is not meeting the needs of current applicants on our wait list. That said, we're always happy to have people apply. I'll be starting the public portion of the community development strategy process soon, asking for input from all committees, boards, commissions, and also the general public. These will be prioritized and submitted to the Housing and Redevelopment Authority for their community development block grant application, which is necessary for continued and improved support for our housing rehabilitation program. Mm-hmm. We do want maximum participation in that. So again, anyone who is who meets the income guidelines, please do apply for housing rehabilitation loans. It's an interest-free loan. If you don't pay it back, it becomes a lien on your house. But you don't have any cash exposure.
And what would examples be that people could get done?
Porches fixed, additions put back onto the house where they've fallen off. Anything that's not up to code can be brought up to code mm-hmm. with this program.
Does that include septic systems too?
That's a different program. We do have a septic revolving fund as well. And lastly, I delivered the framed proclamation to Helen Reed this morning for her 100th birthday, and she was very happy with it.
That's great. That's great. Okay. Thank you, Tom. Any questions for Tom? Concerns of the selectmen. Do we have any concerns?
So I included something in the packet that came from MCAT. I think I didn't include that. But I sent it to Tom. So they want to send out a press release that has to do with the pipeline. And basically saying that the 12 towns that are members of MCAT are in support of the Lakota and pipeline protest. The Lakotas are two Indian tribes mm-hmm. that are protesting the pipeline going through their reservation. And my fear about it is they're implying, I think, more approval by each of the towns than actually exists. And so we're trying to change the wording so we'll say that MCAT is in support of this, but not each individual town. MCAT will vote, you know, by a majority vote to decide whether we want to issue this press release, mm-hmm. but it doesn't mean that every town is in support of it. So,
right.
So there's a lot of editing getting done on the document, so I didn't bring it in. I should give it to you eventually when it gets done.
Sounds good to me.
And that's the Mass Coalition Against the Pipeline?
Yes.
Is that MCAP?
MCAP. Okay. Yeah. And the other thing that I included here was this note that came out today at about 4 o'clock from the Baker administration. Mm-hmm. They have finished their negotiation with Comcast, mm-hmm. so they've signed agreement. You can read the details, but it basically says work is, you know, starting now to expand our Comcast network.
Good. Okay.
Is that 96% coverage going to be in all those towns, or does it vary from town to town?
The amount of coverage right now varies from town to town, and what Comcast agreed to was to raise the coverage so that all of the towns are above 96%. Mm-hmm. And Conway was a bit above 96%.
Yeah.
Do you know what we're at right now, percentage-wise?
We're around 80. And they're going to do close to 200 homes for Conway. It's really significant.
It is.
Yeah. That's great.
If you lived in the Williamsburg end of town,
I know. You hear about it all the time.
Yeah, I'm sure you do.
Especially from the people that are trying to sell their homes out there.
It's really terrible. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, thank you, Bob. Next item is mail. As Tom mentioned, we got a resignation from one of the highway department members, who was a laborer who's worked with us for about a year. Have you guys seen that?
Yes.
And Bob, you mentioned the MTIP email, okay.
So I didn't know if that mail came to you also and came to Tom. I don't know who all got that note from, you know, about the broadband project.
I got it.
You got it too? So, yeah, okay, great. I really wasn't sure if everyone got a copy of it.
Yeah, okay. All right, next item on our agenda is the next meeting is scheduled for September the 6th here in the town office at 7 p.m.
And that is a Tuesday because
and
Monday
Tuesday
is
Tuesday because Monday is Labor Day.
Oh, yeah. Right. Where did the summer go?
Yeah, already.
Good thing it didn't go up in smoke, yeah?
It was dry. That's where it went.
All right, next item is an executive session. We're going to have an executive session under Reason 2 to conduct negotiation sessions with non-union personnel. We're not going to have an executive session under Reasons 3 or 7 tonight. So we'll take a roll call vote and we will adjourn the meeting from the executive session. We'll take a vote now to go into executive session. Bob?
Yes.
Robert?
Yes.
And me. We all vote yes to go into executive session. Thank you, Dan.